العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
الأصل في العبادات المنع والحظر. The origin, the default ruling for any عبادة is that it is prohibited. طيب. The second, where the Sheikh says, بل أجمع المسلمون أنه لم يوجد في عصر خير القرون ولا الذين يلونهم ولا الذين يلونهم. Right, number two. بل, the Sheikh says, أجمع المسلمون. Rather, there is a consensus amongst the Muslims أنه لم يوجد في عصر خير القرون, that it has not been, there's a consensus that it wasn't around during the time of the best of the generations, during the time of the Salaf, the Sahaba, the Tabi'un, and the Atba'u Tabi'een. The three nations in which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي, خَيْرُ أُمَّتِي قَرْنِي, ثُمَّ لَذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ, ثُمَّ لَذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. So it wasn't practiced in this time, and at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the Sahaba, or those that came after them, or those that came after them. وَأَجْمَعُوا أَنَّ الْمُخْتَرَعَ لَهُ السُّلْطَانُ الْمُظَفَّرُ أَبُو السَّعِيدِ الْكُوكَبُورِي إِبْنُ زَيْدِ الْدِّينِ الْعَلِي إِبْنِ بَكْتَكِينَ صَاحِبُ إِقْبَلْ وَعَامِرُ الْجَامِعِ الْمُظَفَّرِ بِالسَّفْحِ قَاصُونَ وَهُوَ فِي الْمِئَةِ السَّابِعَةِ وَلَمْ يَذْكُرْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ بِدْعَةً. طيب. Rather, there's an إجماع. Amongst the Muslims, he says, there's an ijma' that the one that introduced this bid'ah is the Sultan, the Khalifa that was called Al-Muzaffar Abu Sa'id Al-Kukaburi, who died 630 roughly, yani in the 7th century. So there's ijma', the Sheikh says, that that individual was the one that invented it. Yani, na'am. وَلَمْ يَذْكُرْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ بِدْعَةً. And none of the Muslims have mentioned that it is not a bid'ah. Even those that say it is permissible, they say that it is either a bid'ah hasana, or they say it is a bid'ah, lakin bid'ah makruha, is disliked. طيب. So where the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi says that it is, there's ijma' of who started it, there's another opinion, and it is the stronger opinion, that those that started the maulid of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam were a group called the Ubaydiyun, Fatimiyun, Fatimiyun, and they were around in the 4th century, 360. And they were a branch of the Shia. And they were very evil people, and they practiced a lot of kufriyat and a lot of shirkiyat and a lot of bid'ah. From the things they invented was birthdays, the bid'ah of birthdays. So they celebrate the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the birthday of Fatima, Ali, Hassan, Hussein, and the Khalifa of the time, of their time. So they were the ones they introduced it. However, it wasn't commonly practiced amongst Muslims, because the Muslims during that time knew how evil they were and knew that they were not people that were upon the haqq, on the true religion of Allah jalla wa ala. So, طبعاً, it was harder for people to accept their bid'ah. And then this individual came around, this sultan that Imam Shawkani mentioned, and he adopted it, because he was from the Muslims that were not known for having inclination towards the Shia. People followed his guidance, and that's why many people say that he was the one that invented it. طيب. The Sheikh says, يعني قال المصنف رحمه الله عليه, وإذا تقرر هذا لاحظ للناظر أن القائل بجوازه بعد تسليمه أنه بدعة وأن كل بدعة ضلالة بالنص المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يقل إلا بما هو ضد الشريعة المطهرة ولم يتمسك بشيء سوى تقليده لمن قسم البدعة إلى أقسام ليس عليها آثار من العلم. So the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi says that once you have acknowledged that and understood that there's no dalil from the Quran or the Sunnah or the Ijma' or Qiyas, and once you've understood that it was not practiced during the time of the Salaf, and once you have understood that it was introduced in the 7th century, then you will realize that the one that is defending it, he has actually said something which opposes the Sharia of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the Sharia which is purified, this pure Sharia. And he has not held on to anything except blind following. Blind following those who say that it is there's a bid'ah sunnah or hasana, or there's a bid'ah which is makruha and there's a bid'ah which is muharrama. So the individual that claims to celebrate the birthday of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, knowing all of these, that there's no evidence and it wasn't practiced during the time of the Salaf, then in reality he's actually performing something or practicing something which opposes the Sharia of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's blind following those who claim that it is a bid'ah which is hasana or bid'ah which is makruha. طيب. قال المصنف رحمة الله عليه: والحاصل أنه لا نقبل من القائل بالجواز مقالة إلا بعد أن يقيم دليلا يخص هذه البدعة التي يعترف بها في ذلك العموم الذي لا ينكره. وأما مجرد قال فلان وألف فلان فهذا غير نافق أي رائج، والحق أكبر من كل أحد. طيب، the Sheikh in these words, in these sentences, رحمة الله عليه says, طيب, having said that, what? That there's no evidence for the Mawlid from the Quran or the Sunnah or Ijma' or Qiyas, and the fact that it wasn't practiced in the time of the Salaf, and the fact that it was introduced in the 7th century. لا نقبل, then we cannot accept the statement of anyone who says, who comes after that, whilst acknowledging that it is a bid'ah, whilst acknowledging that it is a bid'ah, we won't accept his statement except after giving us a dalil يخصّ هذه البدعة. Underline the. نعم طبعا. Why am I saying underline? You haven't got the books. So why was you, when I was telling you where it says, why did you say anything? Has anyone from the sisters got it on PDF? Naam, you can find it on PDF.
I thought the name on the poster would have indicated.
Given it away.
But maybe next time I should say that, be clearer.
Here I am all day saying, write this, write that. على كل حال نعم على كل حال الشيخ رحمه الله عليه is saying that we can't accept the statement of any individual unless he brings us دليل which is خاص, a دليل which is خاص يخص هذه البدعة, a دليل which refers to this specific بدعة. And we see from there that the Shaykh is saying, anytime you want to perform an ibadah, you have to have a dalil for it specifically. You have to have a dalil for this ibadah specifically. So for Salat al-Isha, مثلاً, you have to have an ibadah for it. For Salat al-Eid, you have to have a dalil for it. A dalil which is khas towards it. Lakin if you say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ, and then you start to make dua during the khutbah as a musalli whilst the imam is giving a khutbah. Whilst the imam is giving the khutbah, if you stand up and you start to make dua, what is this considered? And you take it as a way of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a bid'ah. طيب, is dua bid'ah? Huh? So what makes it a bid'ah? That situation and that time and the fact that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do so. With regards to the salah, طيب, every one of you says peace and salutations upon the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, صح? طيب. How about if a person says اللهم صلي وسلم على نبينا محمد الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين. Permissible? Sunnah? ولا بدعة؟ Why is that? Allahu Akbar. طيب يا وهابي, are you saying it's not permissible to send peace and salutations amongst the messenger upon the messenger?
No.
What? So why are you refusing it? Why are you refusing to start your salah with Allahumma salli wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad? Because there isn't a dalil which is khas to prove that you say the as-salat ala nabi fi hadha al-mawdi'. Rather, there's a dalil that you dalil khas that you say the takbirat al-haram. Just like you can't say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. طيب دليلا يخص هذه المسألة التي يعتبرها. وأما مجرد قال فلان وقال فلان وألف فلان فهذا غير نافق. طيب, as for saying the Sheikh such and such said, or Sheikh فلان said, or العالم الرباني said, or Sheikh الإسلام said, and so on, then that is no evidence. There's no evidence in that. And there's a قاعدة that the scholars use when talking about these sorts of issues, أقوال أهل العلم يحتج لها لا بها. الله يحفظك. Would you be able to write that? أقوال أهل العلم يحتج لها لا بها. Who can explain this? The statements أقوال أهل العلم يحتج لها لا بها. أحسنتي. نعم. The statements of أهل العلم are not evidence within themselves. So you can't say this is a sunnah قال الشيخ فلان كذا وكذا وكذا, or this is halal قال الشيخ فلان كذا كذا كذا. طبعا unless the imam or the sheikh that you're citing brings evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah. لكن to say مجرد فلان said it is permissible therefore we'll do it, and فلان said it is not بدعة, or فلان said it is بدعة حسن, or فلان said it is بدعة مكروهة, then that is باطل, لا يقبل, it is not accepted. As Imam Shawkani says رحمة الله عليه, أقوال أهل العلم يحتج لها لا بها. And the fact that there's a khilaf in a certain issue doesn't mean that it is, or you can use the khilaf as evidence. As he said, وَلَيْسَ كُلُّ خِلَافٍ جَاءَ مُعْتَبَرًا إِلَّا خِلَافٌ لَهُ حَظٌ مِنَ النَّظَرِ. And it is not every khilaf that can be taken as evidence, and there's not every khilaf, not every khilaf can be given consideration, except a khilaf that is based upon evidence from both sides. طيب. So على أن, so the Sheikh رحمة الله عليه in here, in this part, gives us a manhaj which is تربوي, that the statements of أهل العلم, if they oppose the حق, then we reject them. Then we reject them. طيب. So the Shaykh rahmatullahi alayhi says anyone that's got the PDF, page 13. طيب. على أن إذا عولنا على أقوال الرجال ورجعنا إلى التمسك بأذيال القيل والقال فليس القائل بالجواز إلا شذوذا من المسلمين. And even if we go back to those that say, مثلا if we take the statements of Rijal and say the Aqwal, or his Sheikh said, such and such said, and Sheikh this Sheikh said, and this Sheikh said, then those are only a few. If you look into the history of Islam, they're only a few. وَأَمَّا الْعِتْرَةُ الْمُطَهَّرَةُ وَأَتْبَاعُهُمْ فَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُمْ حَرْفًا وَاحِدًا يَدُلْ عَلَى جَوَازِ ذَلِكَ بَلْ كَلِمَتُهُمْ كلمتهم متفقة أو كالمتفقة على بعد حدوث هذه البدعة وأنها من أقبح ذرائع المتمخلعة إلى المفاسد. ولهذا ترى هذه الديار منزهة عن جميع شعائب الشعابذ المتصوفة المتهتكة التي واحدة منها التي هي واحدة منها ولله الحمد. لكن if you look in the majority of the ummah, you will find or you won't find a harf, one word, one letter stating that it is permissible or showing that it is permissible. Rather their kalima and their point of view and their fatawa are mutahida, it is one, meaning that they all understood that it was haram. And then the Shaykh says that this bid'ah and many other bid'ah, walillah alhamd, it wasn't present in his time, yani in the land of Yemen. That was during his time. طيب. Go. There's a mabhath in usul al-fiqh which is called the muqallid and the mujtahid. Who is the mujtahid and who is the muqallid? The muqallid is the blind follower. In these mabahith they talk about who is permissible, who is the one that it is permissible for him to do blind following. They also talk about who is permissible for him to do blind following of. So for the person that has no knowledge, that is a ammi, that isn't able to research, then he's allowed to ask a sheikh for a fatwa. And once he does, he should follow it. Once he does, he should follow it. That's based on what? The fact that he believes that this imam or this sheikh is a taqi, he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's the most knowledgeable person that he can possibly find. So when he gives you a fatwa, then it's for the person that's asking to follow and understand his fatwa. As for the one given the fatwa, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا حَكَمَ الْحَاكِمُ إِذَا اجْتَهَدَ الْحَاكِمُ فَأَخْطَأَ وَأَخْطَأَ فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ وَإِنْ أَصَابَ فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ. As for the hakim, he's either got one reward or two. As for the muqallid, the one that's blind following, verily he has done what Allah jalla wa ala has made wajib upon him. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah jalla wa ala commands us to ask the people of knowledge if we do not know. So for that person, it's wajib upon him to ask the people of Ahlul Ilm. And once he asks those people that he trusts, then he is not blameworthy. However, he can't force his opinion upon other people. Since he's a muqallid, مثلا if there's a mas'ala, and a person does taqleed of someone, مثلا a certain sheikh says to him that it is permissible, and you as a muqallid take the opinion of this sheikh. And then there's another individual, another muqallid, asks another sheikh and says that it is not permissible. Yani the opposite. You can't force your opinion as a muqallid, the opinion that you've taken, upon someone else. Because you're a muqallid aslan. And this individual, he has done that which was wajib upon him. As a muqallid, he's asked his sheikh. Lakin when we're talking about sheikhs, it's not a matter of I'm asking my sheikh and you're asking your sheikh. The person that is being asked has to be a person of Ahlul Ilm. A person of Ahlul Ilm. Lakin if you run to the nearest person who you know is going to give you a fatwa that suits your opinion or what you want him to give, then that obviously goes back to the person and him fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. So the sheikh says, Sheikh Salih al-Husayni. طيب. So the sheikh says, وكان آخر الخلفاء الذين ذابين عن ذلك المهدي لدين الله العباس بن منصور فإنه منع الموالد وأمر بهدم قبور جماعة من الأموات الذين يعتقد بهم العامة والمرجو من الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينهم خليفة عصرنا المنصور بالله سبحانه وتعالى حفظه الله إلى الاقتداء بسلفه الصالح فإن الأمر كما قيل. So the Sheikh is saying that, and from those khulafa, from his era, or the eras just before him, the years just before Imam Shawkani, he says from them there was al-Mahdi al-Din al-Abbas ibn Mansur. His name al-Abbas ibn Mansur, and he prevented people from celebrating all of the birthdays that were around during his time, and he commanded for the qubur and the tombs of those amwat to be, that people have taken as a place of worship, to be destroyed. And he made dua. And he said, we hope that our Khalifa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the tawfiq, yani during the time of Imam Shawkani, gives him the tawfiq to follow the tariq of his salaf. Meaning to destroy all of these tombs that people worship other than Allah jalla wa ala, and also to stop the mawalid that are being celebrated other than, in the time of, or celebrated during the time of the message, during Rabi' al-Awwal, where they celebrate the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you look at the usloob that the Shaykh uses, he makes dua, he says, yani, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give the tawfiq to our Khalifa. That is in contradiction to what Ahl Bid'ah of today are like. When they're talking about the leaders of the Muslims, they mention them in all sorts of degrading, using all sorts of degrading words. So Imam al-Shawkani, Imam al-Salafi, so he said, فَإِنَّ الْأَمْرَ كَمَا قِيلْ أَرَى خَلَلَ الرَّمَادِ وَمِيدَ جَمْرٍ وَيُوشِكُ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ اضْطِرَامُ نعم أو أرى تَحْتَ الرَّمَادِ وَمِيدَ نَارٍ وَيُوشِكُ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ اضْطِرَامُ. This was mentioned by Nasr ibn Yasar Sayyar al-Kannani, and he was said it to one of the Khulafa of the Umayyin. When he saw the Khawarij, he said, verily, in that dust over there, or the fire that has worn out, I see that there's live fire there. Verily, it may be that something is hidden underneath it, or to the like. Meaning he saw the fitna that the Khawarij will bring about. Likewise, the fitna that the Mawalid will bring, celebrating the Mawlid of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is also khatir. The Shaykh says, وَسَيْرَانُ الْبِدْعِ أَسْرَعُ مِنْ سَيْرَيَانِ الْنَارِ لَا سِيَّمَا بِدْعَةُ مَوْلِدِ النَّبِيِّ صلى الله عليه وسلم فَإِنَّ أَنفُسَ الْعَامَةِ تَشْتَاقُ إِلَيْهَا غَايَةَ الْاشْتِيَاقِ لَا سِيَّمَا بَعْدَ حُضُورِ جَمَاعَةٍ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ وَالشَّرَفِ وَالرِّئَاسَةِ مَعْهُمْ فَإِنَّهُ سَيُخَيَّلُ لَهُمْ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ أَنَّ هَذِهِ غَايَةٌ وَلَيْسَتْ بِدْعَةٌ. The Shaykh rahmatullah alayhi says that the spreading of bid'ah is very fast. The spreading of bid'ah into this ummah is very fast. So you will find that if a person introduces a bid'ah, it turns into two bid'ahs, or three, or four, or five, and it's reached all parts of the earth. Why? Because bid'ah naturally is obviously being pushed forward by the shaitan. And many people, or the majority of people, are the ignorant of that which shaitan, or the deceptions of shaitan. Siyama, the Shaykh says, especially if we find that people are using as evidence the people that attend. So they say Shaykh such and such attended, and Shaykh such and such attended. So we see that the wali, or the Shaykh, the alim, the khatib, the qadi, he attended these mawalid and celebration of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birthday. Therefore it's adi if we also do so. And if we also attend the gatherings in which the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birthday has been celebrated. طيب. Due to the time, I'm going to skip some of the lines. That's because we started late. على كل حال وهب أنه لا يحصل بحضرة هؤلاء الأعيان شيء من المنكرات كما يظن بهم ألا يدرون أن العامة تتخذ ذلك وسيلة وذريعة لكل منكر ويصكون بحضورهم وجه كل منكر ويفعلون في موالدهم التي لا يحضرها إلا سقط المتاع كل منكر أو منكر ويقولون قد حضر المولد فلان وفلان وفلان ويتمسكون بجامع اسم المولد. So the Shaykh رحمة الله عليه here in these lines he says, for argument's sake, let's say that it is not a bid'ah. Let's say that celebrating the birthday's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's Messenger's birthday isn't a bid'ah and it isn't haram. Obviously, it is haram, as he has clarified. Like he's saying, he's now moving on to the last issue that he used as evidence, which was what? سَدُّ ذَرَعِعِ هَبْ يعني for argument's sake, let's say that it is not a bid'ah and it is not haram. If we look at what goes on in these mawalid, then there is no doubt that we are left with no option but to say that it is haram to attend. Not because it is haram within itself, lakin because of what goes on. And from the munkarat and the muharramat that goes on, is music being played, free mixing between men and women, people dancing, men dancing, saying lines of poetry which in it are kufriyat and shirkiyat, saying to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he forgives, or saying to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he, or believing that he is amongst them. And from the lines that they say, هذا النبي مع الأحباب قد حضر وسامح الكل فيما قد مضى وجرى. The first line is a bid'ah. Why? Because they're saying هذا النبي مع الأحباب قد حضر. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has come, and he is amongst us. He is amongst us. And طبعاً that is حرام. إنك ميت وإنهم ميتون. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. And also to say that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam attends these gatherings, how many messengers are there? And if we celebrate the birthday of the Prophet in the UK and we say the Messenger qad hadar, the Messenger is here, what about those that are celebrating it in Africa or Asia? Which Prophet is with them? It's like the Shia have about 5 different graves for Hussein radiallahu anhu. As for the second line, وَسَامَحَ الْكُلَّ فِيمَا قَدْ مَضَى وَجَرَى. And not only has he attended our gathering, لكن قد سامح, he has forgiven الكل, he has forgiven everybody for that which has taken place, يعني for all of their sins. طبعا that is كفر. So because these acts are practiced and these lines of poetry are mentioned during these gatherings, then it is haram from that aspect. It is haram from that aspect. And that is, that dalil is called Sadd al-Dhara'i. And it is from the evidences or from the usul of Al-Malikiyya. It is the usul of the Malikiyya. It is the usul of the Malikiyya. And it is used in those issues that there isn't a clear-cut dalil. There isn't a clear-cut dalil. Lakin because of the things that it leads to, and because of the things that take place during the gatherings or during that place, or what it could lead to, then it is called Saddu Dharai, and Allah and the scholars make it haram. I'm going to finish in about 5 minutes. I think it's 4 o'clock. طيب. So this is the part that the Shaykh is using the Sadd al-Dhara'i as an evidence. He says, قال المصنف رحمة الله عليه ومن ها هنا يلوح لك فساد اعتذار بعض المجوزين بأنه إذا لم يحصل في المولد إلا الاجتماع للطعام والذكر فلا بأس به وأنه لا يلزم منه تحريم ما يصحبه من المحرمات تحريمه لأن نقول المولد مع كونه بدعة باعترافك قد صار مصحوبا عادة بكثير من المنكرات وذريعة إلى كثير من المفاسد واتفاق مثل هذه المواليد التي لا تشتمل على غير الطعام والذكر أعز من كبريت الأحمر من الكبريت الأحمر وقد تقرر أن سد الذرائع وقطع العلائق والصائل إلى ما لا يجوز من قواعد الشريعة المهمة التي جزم بها بوجوبها الجمهور وأنت إن بقيت أو إن بقيت فيك بقية من إنصاف لا تنكر هذا. Now, so the Sheikh mentions the masala that we mentioned just now, which was the Sadd al-Dhara'i. So he says, we see here the corruption of those that say it is permissible to attend these gatherings, because all we're doing is gathering together, mentioning the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's biography, his seerah, and remembrance of the Messenger and ta'am, food. We're only giving out food in these gatherings, and we're discussing the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we're talking about the biography of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kind of like a remembrance day, and it's only food that's been given out. فَلَا بَأْسَ بِهِ. So there's no harm in it. And just because there are some things that are muharram that are done through it, then it doesn't make it haram to celebrate the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Lakin the Shaykh says, لِأَنَّا نَقُولُ الْمَوْلِدْ مَعَ كَوْنِهِ بِدْعَةً. The Mawlid, although it's, well, not only is it a bid'ah, the Shaykh says, bi'tirafika, as you have acknowledged, and we know that from those that have mentioned or talked about the mawlid and that said it's permissible, some of them say it's bid'ah, it is makruh. It is a bid'ah, but it is makruh. Some say it is a bid'ah, but it is also what? Hasana. It is a good bid'ah. So the Shaykh says, bi'tirafika. قَدْ صَارَ مَصْحُوبًا عَادَةً بِكَثِيرٍ مِنْ الْمُنْكَرَاتِ. In general, what happens is, as the norm is, that a lot of munkarat or evil takes place in these gatherings. So not only is it gathering for remembering the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ta'am, lakin there are other munkarat, free mixing, music, dancing around, and so on. And also mentioning lines of poetry which give the haqq of ibadah min Allah lil-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taking it from Allah jalla wa ala and giving it to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is also a tariqah, a way, a wasila, or a means to attain a lot of much evil and corruption. واتفاق مثل هذه الموالد التي لا تشمل تشتمل على غير الطعام. As for saying there are gatherings which only the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned, his biography, and there's food given out, then the Shaykh says هذا أعز من كبير من الكبيرة الأحمر. That is a statement, or أعز من الكبيرة الأحمر. It is a statement for those things that are very, very nadir, rare, things that rarely take place. And the scholars say, النادر لا حكمة له. And things that are rare are not to be given the hukum. So the Sharia bases the hukum, whether it's halal, haram, upon the ghalib, the majority. As for if there's a gathering, for example, somewhere in the United Kingdom, in a back room in which they're talking about the biography of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they're giving out samosas, it may take place, lakin in about 1,000 gatherings, there's one. والحكم للغالب لا للنادر. نعم, it is a bid'ah. It is a bid'ah. Lakin for argument's sake, as you've acknowledged that it is a bid'ah, lakin it is a bid'ah hasana, as you can acknowledge. طيب. So that is the dalil of saddu al-dhaga'i'. طيب. والله تعالى أعلم وأحكم.